everyone. I'm Dr. Anjani Devi, Associate Professor, Department of Biotechnology, Vignan's Foundation for Science, Technology and Research. You know pretty well that I'm dealing with the course Enzyme Technology. So we are presently dealing with the Unit 3 of the course Enzyme Technology. So now we will discuss about your sequential reaction, which is also called as ternary complex mechanism. In these enzymes, both the substrates bind to the enzyme at the same time to produce a EAB ternary complex. I've already told you that. So there will be one enzyme and two substrate molecules and are going to bind the enzyme in order to form a ternary complex. That is nothing but EAB. So both the substrate molecules and are going and binding to the enzyme at a time. The form of an enzyme that exists in the solution in the absence of any substrate or other small molecules that can be bound to the enzyme is called as free enzyme. We know pretty well what is a free enzyme, what is a bound form of enzyme and what is a total enzyme. Total enzyme is nothing but the enzyme that is given in the particular reaction. You have added certain amount of enzyme into your reaction mixture. So the amount of enzyme you have added into your reaction mixture is nothing but your total enzyme. Once you have added the enzyme and now you have added your substrate, this substrate will be going and binding to the active site of enzyme. And now some portion of your enzyme is already in bound form with your substrate. If the substrate is present in the high concentration, then entire enzyme that is present in the reaction mixture will be present in the form of enzyme substrate complex. That means entire enzyme, entire concentration of enzyme is available in the form of bound. That is nothing but they are available in the form of bound enzyme. So what is free enzyme? Free enzyme is that enzyme to whose active site no substrate have been attached. So if some substrate was bound to the active site of enzyme, we are calling it as bound enzyme. So an intermediate derived from the free enzyme by binding with the substrate molecule, we are calling it as enzyme substrate complex. As terming those complex as enzyme substrate complex, and after this enzyme substrate complex is formed, there is a formation of products there. Now we are considering the complex as enzyme product complex, and after that there is a release of product molecules from the substrate. A complex derived from the free enzyme and one another molecule is called as binary complex, and one derived from the free enzyme and two other molecules is called as ternary complex. As I already told you, just consider one enzyme molecule. Let us consider one enzyme molecule and one substrate molecule. There is a chance of formation of a complex which is called as a binary complex, as only two molecules, one enzyme molecule and one substrate molecule is available. We are calling it as a binary complex. When two substrate molecules are involved in the reaction and when two substrate molecules binds with the enzyme molecule, there is a formation of a ternary complex. One enzyme molecule and two substrate molecules, we are calling it as a ternary complex. So now I think you have understood, you have a clear idea about what is a binary complex and what is a ternary complex. So there are two types of mechanisms here in the sequential mechanism. I've already told you that they are random order mechanism and compulsory ordered mechanisms. As I've explained you that there are two types of sequential reactions. One is your ordered sequential reactions and another one is your compulsory sequential reactions. I'll explain you about this ordered sequential reactions. What is happening in this ordered sequential reactions? Why we are calling the sequential reactions as ordered sequential reactions? Because all the substrates are binding to the enzymes in a proper order, in a proper sequence. Similarly, the products are also released from the enzymes in a sequence or in an order. That means the addition of your substrates to the enzyme as well as release of your products from your enzyme are also taking place in a sequential and in an orderly way. I'll explain you with the help of an example. Let us consider an enzyme lactate dehydrogenase. This enzyme is catalyzing the reaction where pyruvate is getting converted into lactate. In this particular reaction, the enzyme should be first bound to the coenzyme. here the coenzyme involved in this particular reaction is nothing but the NADH. Once this coenzyme will be going and bind into the enzyme, now your enzyme will be active, and now your enzyme will be acting upon the substrate molecule. So before the substrate goes and binds to the enzyme, the coenzyme should bind to the enzyme. This is in a proper order. So once the binding of this coenzyme as well as the substrate take place, the reaction will be taking place, and there is a formation of product which is nothing but lactate. Lactate is a product. The pyruvate is reduced to form lactate, and NADH is oxidized to form NAD+. So here we are going to get two products. One is your lactate and another one is your NADH. As during the initial point of the reaction, NADH is bound to the enzyme first, followed by your pyruvate. After the reaction have taken place, lactate is released first, followed by the release of NAD+, and your original enzyme is retained. So the addition of the substrates as well as release of your products to the enzyme will be carried out in a sequential or orderly way. Same thing we are calling it as compulsory ordered mechanism. Here, in multiple reactant mechanisms, catalyzed reactions, if the reactants must bind to the enzyme's active site in a specific order, the reaction type is called as compulsory ordered reaction or compulsory ordered mechanism. Here, there is a formation of ternary complex. See, you can see the example here. Your enzyme is present. To that, a first substrate molecule is going to bind. Then there is a chance of formation of your binary complex. Now another substrate B is getting bound to your binary complex to form a ternary complex. Now your second substrate is getting released, and you again have a binary complex here, and after that there is a release of your initial substrate in the form of product, and you are regaining back your enzyme. Now I'm going to explain you about random ordered mechanism. What is this random ordered mechanism? In the random sequential reaction, the substrate and the products are bound and they are released in a no preferred order. That means there is no proper order for binding of your substrate to the enzyme, and there is no proper order for the release of your products from your enzyme. This mechanism can generally be expressed as a following equation. You see this equation here. Let us consider an equation with one enzyme molecule and two substrate molecules A and B, and the product will be P and Q. See here, your enzyme is present. There is every chance that any of the substrate can come and bind. Let us think the order. First A is coming, and then B is coming and binding to the enzymes. Then there is a formation of EAB complex. If we take another probability, first the second substrate B is coming and binding to the enzyme, followed by addition of the first substrate A. Ultimately, there is a formation of a ternary complex, which is nothing but EAB. So, after that, after the reaction takes place, there is a formation of EPQ complex, where E is your enzyme and PQ are your products. So, see the probability, second probability here. So, any of the products means either P or Q can be released first. Let us consider a situation where P is released first from the enzyme. Now you have a binary complex of only EQ. In the situation, if your Q is released first, then you have a binary complex EP. Ultimately, the products are released and you regain your enzyme in your original form. I'll explain the same reaction with the help of another example. Let me consider an enzyme creatine kinase. So this will be acting upon creatine plus ATP, giving rise to phosphocreatine, phosphocreatine plus your ADP in the presence of creatine kinase. We have considered an enzyme creatine kinase, which will be acting upon the substrate creatine. This is your first substrate. In the presence of second substrate, that is your ATP, you are going to get two products. One is your phosphocreatine as well as your ADP. In this case, either of the substrate, that means creatine can first come and bind to the creatine kinase, or ATP can first come and bind to the creatine kinase. That means either of your substrate can go and bind to the enzyme. Similarly, either of your products can be get released from the enzyme first. So there is no hard and fast rule that a proper order should follow for binding of your substrate to the enzyme as well as release of your product from your enzyme. So a ternary complex is still observed for the random sequence reactions. I've shown you here. So either in the case where A will be binding first followed by B, or B will be coming and binding to enzyme followed by A, there is a formation of a ternary complex, that is EAB complex. So the ternary complex will be formed in this particular sequential reaction also. Before catalysis, the complex includes the enzyme, ATP and creatine. Here, what is the complex that is available before the reaction? The complex, the ternary complex, will be containing your enzyme creatine kinase along with your creatine and ATP. After the reaction is formed, again you will be having a ternary complex containing your phosphocreatine and ADP as well as your creatine kinase. So, either before the reaction or after the reaction, you will be finding a ternary complex formation. Now, we'll just focus upon what is this pre-steady state kinetics. What is this pre-steady state? So, the pre-steady state in enzyme catalyzed reactions occupy very short period of time. That means this pre-steady state will be existing only for few seconds and very low amount of product concentrations. Let us consider a reaction which is not too fast. You can stop that reaction by using this proper flow technique, and it can be used to measure the rate of reaction when compared to the fast ordered reaction. Similarly, if you consider the reactions which will be completed within less than 1 minute of time, then you can use relaxation techniques. And in these techniques, the system is disturbed. In either of these techniques, if you use any of these techniques, either when you increase the temperature of the system, if you change the pH of the system, if you stop the reaction, in any situation, there is a chance of disturbances in the system. But the disturbance is not too high. The disturbance will not hamper the equilibrium of the reaction. It won't change the equilibrium of the reaction. So, in temperature jump techniques, the temperature is increased rapidly and the system relaxes to a new state of equilibrium or a new steady state at the final temperature. In the pressure jump technique also, the pressure is rapidly changed. So, if you change the pressure also, if you change the temperature also, if you stop the reaction also, so in any situation, there will be some disturbances in the system. That is nothing but in the reaction process, there will be some disturbance, but the equilibrium of the reaction will not be changed. That particular situation is called as pre-steady state. This will be last only for fractions of seconds. Now we will see what is a steady state. A condition of physical system or a device that does not change over time, or in which any one change is continuously balanced by another, such as stable conditions of the system in the equilibrium. That particular state is called as your steady state. That means even some change is taking place, the change will be compensated by another change. So ultimately, the change in the system will be balanced. So the state of this particular reaction is called as a steady state. And a general rate equation is given by Alberti in the year 1953. Previous sessions we have discussed about MM equations in the case of with respect to your single substrate reaction. If you consider two substrate reactions also, there is every chance that your two substrate reaction also obeys the MM equation. But one condition should be satisfied. The concentration of your one of your substrates should be constant. Only in that particular situation, the two substrate reaction also will obey the MM equation. So, two substrate reactions obey MM equation with respect to one substrate at constant concentration. There should not be any change in the concentration of one substrate. So, the change in the concentration of the another substrate will be affecting the reaction now. This is your Alberti's general rate equation. So here we are giving that it's more or less your Michaelis-Menten equation. V is equal to V max into AX and B. AX and B are nothing but the concentration of two substrates. Actually, according to MM equation, V is equal to V max into S divided by KM plus S. So similarly, the rate of the reaction is equal to V max, the same as here. And in the place of substrate concentration, we have incorporated the concentration of AX and B. This is one of the substrate molecule and this is another substrate molecule. And it is divided by KM. As usual, the KM for your one of your substrate and the KM for your second substrate, followed by your concentration of both the substrates. So you can see the interpretation of your expression here. Coming to today's summary, in today's session, we have discussed about what is the importance of Michaelis-Menten parameters, how to determine the Michaelis-Menten parameters such as V, max and KM. So we have studied about various plots. We have discussed about various plots like Lineweaver-Bug plot, Getty-Hansky plot, Hans plot, etc., which are very much useful in order to determine the KM and Vmax. And along with that, we have also studied about multi-substrate reaction mechanisms and their kinetics. We have studied about bye-bye reactions. In that, we have also studied about the sequential reactions as well as the non-sequential reactions. So, in the sequential reactions, in the sequential mechanism, we have studied about the random ordered mechanism as well as your compulsory ordered mechanism models. And coming to this non-sequential mechanism, we have studied about the ping-pong mechanism also. So, with this, I am going to wind up today's session. I want you people to work upon all these questions to assess yourself how far you have understood from today's session. And moreover, you can refer these references. So, you can see these slides as well as you can get the information from the book. There is nothing but your Palmer. Thank you.